What is the foundation of everything you think about day and night? I am this body. Think and witness for yourself what happens due to this I am this body. Since you're on a continuous rant of I am this body, therefore, all that could have happened has now got limited to I am this body. This is what limited thinking is, the root cause of all the sorrow. Say, I am this space, infinite space. Where's thought? Thought will be alive till you think of yourself as a form. The moment you realize that you're the formless, thought disappears. Now the thought is entirely yours. If you want to use it, do that. If not, then don't. Essence, which is being continuously mentioned here. What does be in essence actually mean? Your essence is formless. So when you try to think about the formless, thought comes to an end. Now there is only awareness left, free from the limitations of the form. Now even if thought is still there, it won't affect you because you know that there's no way to limit the essence. For a few seconds, I might think that I am this body, but that isn't going to affect anything because I am still going to be infinite. For a moment, I can act as a beggar, but that will not affect me because I am a king. And these are just examples in which you shouldn't entangle yourself. In reality, I am neither a king nor a beggar. I am the lifeline of both. So, actually, you don't die, but die every moment at the level of thoughts. In reality, you aren't sad, but at the level of thoughts, you are. Once you have understood your real nature, you will stop being sad, even at the level of thoughts. You won't be sad, even if you'd want to. Impossible. In essence, you are always liberated. It's a very, very big statement. There is no problem at the actual level, but what we have assumed ourselves to be, there lies the problem. Because our upbringing has been such, and the world around us, the conditioning, this body's structure is as such, that all the experiences which happen always seem to be happening to me. Whatever happens throughout the day is strengthening this I, which is the root cause of all the sorrow. That I which is identified with this body. When you ask the root cause of all this, it is ignorance. Since I do not know who I am, that is why I am unhappy. Now you might ask, why don't I know? Take an example, not literally, that since a person is uneducated, that's why he suffers. What is the solution to that illiteracy? Education. He needs to go to school and learn and understand. If he understands, then at least his survival is ensured. I'm not talking about happiness. I'm talking only about survival. I hope we understand the difference between the two. One is survival from outside, which depends on our skills. The better my skills are, the better my life will be ensured. I'll be able to give a comfortable life to myself and the people around me. The better my qualifications are, the better I'll survive in this outside world. Money is important, isn't it? Ask someone who doesn't have it. Meaning, you have lesser than you need in this object-oriented world. Then, you'll suffer without a doubt. Similarly, within you, if your thoughts are smaller than how big they should be, then too, you will suffer. How big should your thoughts be? As big as you are, because lesser than that just won't work. If it is lesser than that, then you'll suffer. What are you actually? Infinite. No one loves death. You'll suffer just by the thought of death, be it yours or someone else's. You'll be frightened by death's mere mention. You are internally poor at the level of your thoughts. What is the solution to this? Be richer at the level of your thoughts. On the outside, you are poor, and you and your family are suffering. Everyone is dying of hunger. How do you solve it? You have to be rich. From within, everyone is poor by default. King or the peasants, everyone. Because what they actually are, in comparison to that, they are poor. So education in the inner world is when you understand who you really are. You have to see the reality. If we see that reality, understand it, and start thinking accordingly, then your thoughts will automatically take that route. It's that simple. When you understand who you are in your inner world, then you won't need to train your thoughts. If you have to train your thoughts, then you haven't yet understood. Thoughts will automatically take the correct course and will never sway. If I am a king, I will think like a king and not like a beggar. Is it not? If someone comes and tells me that I'm a beggar, I'll put him in jail. Isn't that true? I'm the king. So, thoughts will automatically take the right track. Words will be spoken accordingly. What is the solution to all this? Understanding. Can this understanding occur within a day or immediately? A child went to school and came out the other day proclaiming he has learned everything. Does it happen that way? It's a slow, steady, and gradual process. That's why satsang, or good company, is considered so important in India. During the old days, each home had a satsang hall. Satsang was held every day. So, it takes time. You need to have a lot of patience. Like you need patience on the outside. If you go to a school, you need patience. If a child is learning carpentry, he needs a lot of patience. There will be pain in his body. He must tolerate that pain if he needs a comfortable life for himself. So, if you want a comfortable mind, a stress-free life, a restful sleep, then you need to absolutely work on this end. Doesn't matter how much pain you suffer, how much time it takes. There is no alternative to this. It is a slow and steady process. You don't understand all of this in a single day. Take a lot of time, but it is worth it. Every single moment spent on this is worth it because you are looking at your own vastness from here. There's a different enjoyment to this. In the outer world, when you are looking outside or reading about the outer world, you are looking at the vastness of the outer world. The more you see it, the more frightened you will be. You'll feel insecure. What is your importance in this huge world? Nothing. When you look at the vastness inside you, then you actually look at your own vastness. Then, this outside world, which is actually huge, this universe, where billions of people are there, even this universe will be a small dot for you. This is what Ashtavakraji is saying to King Janak. You are the only witness of everything in this entire universe, meaning the witness is only one. Soul is only one. They aren't different. He who knows all of this is liberated. There's no way to bind him. Like, there's no way to bind your awareness. You see something right now. And you may see something else tomorrow. It might be something good or bad. There will be some reactions due to good or bad. It doesn't matter. You can see, can't see. Even that doesn't matter. Doesn't matter if you see the light or darkness. Your bondage is that you think of the witness as someone separate from you. This is a huge statement. This is the essence of the entire Ashtavakra Gita. This is called wisdom, meaning that you are the only one who witnesses all of this. If there is no one to witness or to experience, then who'll feel happiness and sorrow? Will there be something called happiness or sorrow in this world? If there's no experience, no feelings, no thoughts, then who will have a problem? Then there's no separation at all. Whatever is happening in this world, what is the base if there is no one to witness? Call it witness, awareness, or consciousness. It's one and the same. But in the West, people made a concept even out of consciousness because they think of consciousness as something separate from them, a phenomenon. They are committing the same mistake which has been committed by countless people in the past. They are mixing consciousness with thoughts. They think that even consciousness is controllable. So, we need to calmly understand what this mistake is. We consider the one who sees or witnesses as someone separate. Why? Because we do this all day and night. Whereas, the truth is that there are not multiple witnesses in different bodies. There is no separation in consciousness, and it is absolutely free from action-reaction, cause-effect. But the mistake we commit is what everyone else commits. Whenever we say, I am fat, I am thin, don't we say these? Where is this I? It is identified with the body. Our entire conversation throughout the day, if you think keenly, there is either I or you implied all the time. Either this or that. For objects, we can use this or that. For people, it'll be I and you. You meaning that which is different from I. There's a separation, isn't there? I meaning I am this. You are different from me. We never question what I is. I am hungry. Now where have we identified ourselves? Initially, we identified ourselves in the physical, outer appearance. Now, we identified ourselves in the physiological functions of the body. I am hungry. I am thirsty. Body is hungry. Body is thirsty. Then we say, I feel good. I am very happy. Now we have identified ourselves with a feeling. That feeling was born and it died. A person was fat and got thinner the next day. So, who am I? Was I he who got attached to that feeling? Or I didn't get attached at all? That feeling came and faded away. So many feelings come and go, but we never inquire this. If we understand this small thing, that the feeling of happiness came and went away, but neither was I born or died. I say, I am happy. If this is not an error, then what is? This is the real enlightenment if you understand this closely. There can't be a thing bigger than this. This means that no matter what kind of feeling comes, it may be a good one or a really bad one, that won't affect my being at all. Let it come. We'll encounter that feeling. Let's see the best feeling of this world. I'm open to it. What's the worst feeling of this world? I'll face it too. I'm open to it. So what is attached to the body? All kinds of sensations. What is attached to the mind? Feelings and emotions. What is attached to the intellect? Thoughts and words. So, whenever there is a feeling, sensation, emotion, or a thought, then we assume that I am. It won't be incorrect to say that we refer to this very thing as I am. If I ask you, what are you? I am seeing. This is me. Right now, you aren't seeing. You're listening. So who are you? He who is listening, or he who is seeing. Meaning, whenever your thoughts get connected to an object, then you perceive that I am, and when it doesn't, then you think I am not. At that moment, I am nothing. How can you be nothing? When there's a form, there's a sensation. Or when we're speaking to ourselves, then we think that I am. But when we stop talking, then we don't understand what's happening. That's why people are afraid of meditation, because everything is drifting away. Leaving away is equivalent to dying. They can't stay silent, neither from the outside nor from within, because they fear death. They fear silence. When they keep talking, when they keep doing something, when they see something, then they have the feeling of them being alive. When they see something, then they think they are. They keep on doing something outside and inside. Tell them to sit silently without doing anything. They can't leave their thoughts. Why not? Because they're afraid. In the known, they are comfortable, even if it is miserable. The unknown is frightening to them. We always hold on to something or someone. Why? Because if we don't do that, then who are we? If a person does not hold on to his memories or his perceptions, then who is he? He won't know at all. This is called ignorance. If someone perfectly understands what he is, then the point of thought being or not being is equal to him. Whether feelings are or are not, it is same for him. Body is not, is the same for him. This is wisdom. He's very clear about what dies and what doesn't, because he who himself doesn't die can understand what can die. To understand a feeling which occurred and died, there has to be someone who was before the occurrence of the feeling, during the feeling, and after that feeling. This should be absolutely clear. This is what being present actually means. If our understanding is based upon what we actually are, we detach ourselves from thoughts too. We become indifferent to the presence and absence of thoughts. This is the highest possible state. There are few people who have latched on to the thoughts. They can't leave them. They are restless. They are continuously thinking and blabbering something throughout the day, both outside and within. They are restless. There are few people who want to get rid of these thoughts. They go to the mountains, do meditation, do this and that. But the knower of the truth becomes indifferent to both these states. For that, being in meditation, being in a thoughtless state, in a thoughtful state, in good thoughts, in bad thoughts, in good or bad feeling, it does not matter to him. All are equal to him. He is open for everything and everyone. And that which is open to everything and everyone is the truth. That which is the essence of everything is the truth. And the truth is not different from you. You are that.